today I'm going to do an unboxing video of sorts, and it's going to be done with the help of what's in this box. And it's going to help explain the history of resistance as it relates to PAF pickups. Stay tuned. So today I'm going to do a little video about resistance in PAF pickups. There's a little bit of a mystery or misconception about resistance and PAF pickups as to why they vary so widely. So one of these details is whether or not Gibson actually took resistance readings, because the PAF pickups vary so widely, it would seem counterintuitive that they actually took a resistance reading. So today I will show that they did, and they did it with this meter right here. It's an Allen E622 ohmmeter. And inside here, this one is from, I don't know if you can read this, it says 729-1959. So this is era specific, but this is the ohmmeter that Gibson used and actually had at winding stations in the 50s. So, and I'll do an unboxing here in just a second. Okay, so inside this box, this rather dirty old box, is this box, which is, along with this paperwork here, this is the actual type of ohmmeter that Gibson used. Now, how do I know that? This ohmmeter is made by Allen Equipment Company, which is less than a mile away from Kalamazoo. I have a winder that Gibson purchased from Allen Equipment Company, and I know this winder was purchased from them because it has their tool tag on it, and I have the purchase record from the original manufacturer of the winder of it shipping to Allen Equipment in Kalamazoo. So, Allen Equipment was an electrical supply place as well as a manufacturer, and one of the things they manufactured was ohmmeters. Well, I have a photo from the 50s of the winder that Allen Equipment supplied to Gibson in use in the 50s, and in that photo is an ohmmeter. So I thought at the time, I thought once I figured out Allen Equipment actually supplied these the specific winder in the photo, I thought, I wonder if they supplied the ohmmeter. So I looked up on eBay, Allen Equipment ohmmeters, and they just so happen to have the one in the photo. And this is it right here. I purchased it, and it's the exact ohmmeter in the photo. Now, this isn't the exact ohmmeter, but this is the same model of ohmmeter that is in the photo. It makes sense Gibson would use this, since Allen was a local supplier less than a mile away from Gibson, Kalamazoo, and they also bought winding machines from them. So this is a very heavy-duty ohmmeter, and if you're at the level of sort of guitar geekery that I am, you'll want to find one. But the one I found is in really great shape. It runs on a D-sized battery. And I had to do just a little work to get it to operate. The wire that was for the probes was all deteriorated. The rubber had deteriorated. So I replaced it with this braided wire, which probably wasn't the best idea because now the braided wire gets in the way of the probes. But it looks cool. But this ohmmeter is interesting in several regards. As you can see from the photo, Gibson actually had these at winding stations, But the resolution on this meter, when you get up to 7K, is only half an ohm. So this is one reason there is Gibson PAF pickups, and P90s vary. The resolution of the meter that they use is only half an ohm. So although there's increments, the half an ohm is the smallest increment, there's obviously sweep of the meter between those increments, but you can't really reliably get a precise reference without a little hash mark for it. And those hash marks at 7K and above only come every 0.5K. So that's part of the explanation. Inside the box, too, there's paperwork. And this one, it says the instructions here were from 1952. But this one obviously shipped in 59. So this is era-specific. Allen Electric Equipment. Right there, Kalamazoo, Michigan. I think there's a card in here that shows the address. Yeah, this is sort of a mail-in card, and that right there shows the address. It says 2101 through 2117 North Pitcher Street, Kalamazoo, Michigan. And if you look that up on Google Maps, it's less than a mile from the Kalamazoo factory for Gibson. So it's not a surprise they would use this or purchase it locally, considering the history they had with purchasing winding machines from them. So that's kind of a cool detail as far as the history of ohmmeters and Gibson, and whether or not they actually took a resistance reading of their pickups. They clearly did, and they use this type of meter for it, this specific model meter. Next, I'll give a few more details about some other variables that account for the difference in resistance readings between PAF pickups and even pickups now that a lot of people don't really think about when they're getting pickups. That'll be next. Okay, so some other details that account for variation in resistance for a PAF pickup, or in this instance any pickup, is temperature variation. A pickup like this will change its reading with ambient temperature. In fact, just me holding this right now, it's going to increase the resistance reading. So if you've ever been into the old Gibson Kalamazoo factory, it's an old steam heat building, and it's not hard to imagine that the temperature varied by quite a few degrees throughout the year, maybe throughout the day. When we wind pickups at ThroBak, I keep the temperature at 73 degrees year-round. Now, that allows us to make a very consistent pickup, but I don't think Gibson had the luxury or even the motivation to do that. So that's one detail that affects any pickup. Variation in temperature will change the reading of the same pickup, depending upon what the ambient temperature was and the temperature of the pickup was when the reading was taken. Another detail that is really more specific to the 50s era is the tolerance of magnet wire in the 50s. A pickup like this in the 50s would be wound with 42-gauge plain enamel wire on both bobbins. Now, in the 50s, when you ordered 42-gauge plain enamel wire, you got the full range of tolerance within 42 gauge. And basically that's a 14% variance from smallest size within that tolerance to the highest size. So there's a 14% variation both in outside diameter and ohms per foot with vintage magnet wire. The tolerance is still the same today, but if you order magnet wire today, they further subdivide it into what's called min to nominal tolerance and nominal to maximum tolerance. And the vast majority of pickup makers use the smaller end of the tolerance because it's one way to get a more consistent pickup. But and that creates a variation of only 7% rather than 14% in diameter and in ohms per foot. Vintage wire was not subdivided this way. So you get this 14% variation now, just from the tolerance of the wire, potentially. So that's built into a vintage PAF pickup, or P90. The way I handle it at ThroBak is I want that same variation in tolerance, but I want a very consistent pickup from... I want to make sure that people get a pickup. Today, they get it. Maybe want to get another of the same model 2 years from now, that they're getting the same thing. So what I do is I order the full range of that tolerance, and then I use a micrometer for each spool, and I also measure the diameter of the wire for each spool, and I also measure the ohms per foot for each spool. I sort the wire, and then I have it assigned to dedicated winding stations on the two Lisona 102s I have, and the other multi-station winders that I have that are the same models that Gibson used, including two of the machines Gibson used, actually out of the factory. So I can get that vintage variation in tolerance, but have it very repeatable. A larger manufacturer, even a smaller one, might very well prefer to use, and very often do prefer to use, the min to nominal tolerance that is available today. And a very small manufacturer would be making all coils off of that one spool in the name of consistency, and makes it easier for them to make a consistent product that way. But you don't get this variation between spools that are built into to vintage pickups, because they used multi-station winding machines. And they also had a wire supply that had this 14% variance in tolerance for ohms per foot in diameter, rather than the 7% variance in tolerance that ordering min to nominal wire will get you today. Hope that made sense. Okay, so another variation in the resistance reading of a PAF pickup, or a P90, is the turn count. And this is kind of often cited as the main reason there's variation in PAF pickups, is that the myth being that winders from PAF, the PAF era, did not have counters. Well, they all had counters, and I'm quite sure of that. They didn't all have auto-stop counters, though. So in order to have a consistent turn count on those machines that didn't have auto-stop counters, you'd have to have it very closely attended to, or you would time it. And I think in the case of Gibson, it was a combination of those two methods in the 50s, which right there leads to a variation and turn count, and resulting a variation in ohms, or the finished resistance count of the finished pickup, and also a variation between coils. That variation between coils can also be due to the wire tolerance, as mentioned before, but turn count is another important detail. And then the final detail is turn per layer, as it relates to the machine they used. Turn per layer for the specific machines varied. Some of them were the same turn per layer, and some of them were different. I don't think this was the detail Gibson paid too much attention to, and when you actually have the machines, you can see how they set it up. They would use the suggested turn per layer for that gauge of wire as instructed in the manual for that machine, which is the logical thing to do. For whatever reason, that varies between these models of machines, and I still haven't figured that one out. But when you get the machine and you get the manual, it's clear as day. This is the difference. There is one exception to this. Gibson has at least one handmade machine that they made, which has a turn per layer count that is different than either of the other turn per layer counts of machines that they purchased. It's kind of totally out of whack, but it makes great sounding pickups, so I'm not complaining. Anyway, all of those details add up to variation in resistance of a finished assembled pickup when we're talking about PAFs. And I'll get maybe a little more into the details of difference between a new old stock wire and current production wire and turn per layer. But as a general overview, that's how the variation of one of these in resistance came about. So, and remember, when next time you're on eBay, if you're like me, you're gonna want to find one of these. So it's an, if you just search Allen Ohmmeter, maybe you'll luck out like me and get one. But maybe I'll buy them all first. I only need one. But the collector needs many more. And again, thanks for letting ThroBak be a part of your search for guitar tone. There's lots of details that go into this stuff. If you like the video, click like, and subscribe to my YouTube channel, and I'll have more videos like this, and hopefully you'll enjoy those too. Thanks again.